All right, let's continue from where we left last time. We're going to look at the steps in the anaerobic digestion system. An anaerobic digestion consists of four major parts, or major steps, if I use that word. There's the hydrolysis. Another one, which is the second one step, is known by the scientific word of acidogenesis, or it can be known by the common word of fermentation. The third step is called acetogenesis, and then there is the last step called methanogenesis. So, okay, in your notes you're going to see each of the steps, what it accomplishes. For example, if I may just give an overview, the first step is where you've got things such as the complex organic matter, whereby it's broken into the simple parts. You're talking about proteins being broken into amino acids, fats being broken into what? Into the fatty acids plus glycerol, and carbohydrates being broken into glucose and the rest, yeah. And then so this means that in a way you can be able to quicken an anaerobic digestion if you can undertake the hydrolysis step through some other method, yeah. For example, you're going to see that if you want the digestion to take place easier, for example, if you have waste food, and if you've got a small fire, why can't you just boil whatever the waste in a small container to about 50-60 degrees for some time, and then now put it in a container? In that case, most of the bones are going to be broken down, and therefore the bacteria is going to have an easier time breaking down the waste. So the first step, you can there can be human intervention, or it can take time in nature, but it's going to take an extended period. So you can be able to really ensure that the hydrolysis can take place quicker if you want the anaerobic digestion to be faster. Okay, the next step is where the there is something whereby the pH is going to go down, but it's made use of another bacteria called acidogenesis bacteria. In that case, the pH is going to go down. So that's going to be the second step, but each of the steps, once again, I would not want to put on the board because of the. It's easier for you to look at those steps from your later notes. It is much easier to look at those steps. I think it's on page 6 of your later notes. It's written stages of the anaerobic digestion. Yeah? So you'll be able to look at those stages. After the acidogenesis step, then there's the last step, which is called the methanogenesis step, which is what I will be focusing on, because it is the last step that it's like the rate determining step. It's like they do or die. If something happens to the last step, then there will not be any anaerobic digestion. So and all the other bacteria, once again, this thing does not involve maybe like what, viruses or whatever, or maybe enzymes, but it's going to involve what, bacteria. So there is the hydrolysis step, which can take place by nature, but if you leave it time, then the food is going to break down on its own. But the bacteria which are involved in the last step, they are quite sensitive. They are sensitive to the pH, in that they can only survive in the pH range of between 6.8 and 7.2. As you know, the optimum the neutral pH is pH 7. That is the pH is, you know the pH range, 0 to 14. From 0 to about 6.9, that medium will be taken to be acidic. From 7.1 up to 14 is going to be taken to be basic, yeah? So pH 7, like distilled water, is going to be said to be pH 7, yeah? So in this case, you're talking about this methanogenic bacteria. They can only survive in the pH range of 6.8 to 7.2. So what does this mean? That if you're going to allow perhaps I may mention this, but I'm going to mention later under the digestion failure. If I'm just going to say, hey, there's a lot of food, why don't I dump a lot of food onto something like a digester and let the bacteria have fun on this? If you're going to put in a lot of organic material, it's going to the bacteria will be overwhelmed by the second step, where there will be the fermentation. Fermentation is where there will be the production of the volatile acids like acetic acid. And as you know, carboxylic acids, just like mineral acids, have got a low pH. And any pH less than 7, especially in this case, if you're going to put a lot of organic material, the pH will go to probably 3 or 2 or probably 1. And that will kill the methanogenic bacteria. So you must ensure that you just put sufficient organic material. So there are some conditions that must be maintained. For example, something called the organic loading rate, but all these factors are in your notes, yeah? The notes are quite detailed, and I believe you'll be able to look at those notes. But I'm mentioning some of the things that may not be very, very clear in the notes. These methanogenic bacteria are easy to kill. By easy to kill, it means that if you're going to avoid some conditions whereby probably there will be a crack in the anaerobic digestion, so that oxygen comes into the digester, then it's going to kill these methanogenic bacteria, and then the biogas production is going to stop. And also, if the pH is outside a certain range, then that will also kill the anaerobic digestion. So I want to mention a few things about anaerobic digestive failure. I believe you've seen probably in the marketplaces or in other places, you've been told this was initially a working anaerobic digestion, but then something has happened. There's no more biogas that is being produced. What happened? If you do not observe certain conditions, then the bacteria will be overwhelmed by toxins or some other things, and anaerobic digestion is going to take place. So I'm just listing some of the things here, but once again, all these details as to what each of those things does is listed in your lecture notes. Sorry, I've not put my the color nicely. Once again, I'm just mentioning a few things. If there is too much organic feed, it's going to cause what? The pH to go lower than 6.8, and therefore that will upset the methanogenic bacteria, and then once they're upset, they're not going to convert the acids plus hydrogen into carbon dioxide plus methane. If once again on the other side you put too little feed, the bacteria are going to die because of hunger, because there will not be enough food for them to feed on. Yeah, in that case, that's what you're talking about: too dilute feed. It means the organic matter that is coming in is too dilute, and therefore the bacteria are going to die because of hunger, because of lacking food. Now, there comes a time whereby you need to operate the digestion in such a way that that after a certain period you open a tap to be able to remove the waste which has been eaten by the bacteria. It's called the digestate, and then you let in the new material, because the anaerobic digester has got a certain specific volume, and you may not be able to accept that volume. So if you're going to open the tap to let in a lot of fluid waste, which is called the digestate, then you might get rid of most of the bacteria that has multiplied, which is responsible for the anaerobic digestion. This is called washout, whereby you've now gotten rid of the bacteria, and therefore you've seen that initially there was biogas which was being produced, and then suddenly the rate has gone down, because the bacteria which were responsible for the digestion, you've actually gotten rid of getting rid of the waste. Now, bacteria which are responsible for the biogas production are living organisms, and any living organism can only survive in the enabling environment. So if there are things such as heavy metals, maybe even sodium chloride, which is of harmful concentration, ammonia, and so many other things, wrong pH, that's going to do what? That's going to kill the bacteria. So you need to ensure that if you're dealing with anaerobic digestion from industrial waste, for example, you need to ensure you take care of them, or that they are not toxic, yeah? Otherwise, those are going to kill the anaerobic bacteria. Once again, the issue about the pH is going to be mentioned again and again and again and again. If you're dealing with the cyclophilic anaerobic digestion, the bacteria are actually sensitive, and they're not very sensitive, so they're quite tolerant to the pH ranges. You're talking about probably up to fluctuations of about 10 degrees, maybe from between 15 degrees, about 25 degrees, maybe the bacteria can really survive. But if you're dealing with mesophilic anaerobic digestion, whereby it takes place at around 37 degrees, you've got a tolerance of a maximum of 3 degrees. For instance, if you're talking about a digester which is being operated at 37 degrees, if the temperature will change, it can only change up to 34 degrees before the bacteria is upset. And the maximum on the other side is up to 40 degrees. So there is a maximum of up to 3 degrees variations. For the for the thermophilic, you've got only a temperature variation of only 1 degree, 55. If it goes beyond 54 degrees, no biogas production. If it goes beyond 56 degrees, no biogas production. So you only have a 1 degree tolerance. Now, okay, I've mentioned about wide variations in the temperature. Something else which can affect the biogas production, or which can lead to the digestive failure, is when there is no mixing. What it is this: the feed can settle at the bottom, and that will mean that the bacteria which is mostly floating in the solution is not going to get food, even though the food is in the digestion, but actually at the bottom. So you need to get a mechanical stirrer to really ensure that the contents of the reactor are actually mixing in a regular manner. So if there is no stirring, then that can lead to digestion failure. And once again, what is this thing you are going to call a retention time? This is the period in which, once you put your the waste organic matter onto a digester, there's a certain period in hours or days. You're talking about hours for the thermophilic digestion, which takes place quickly, mesophilic takes place in a few hours or days, as opposed to sacrophilic, it can take days or weeks or whatever. So if you do not observe, if you do not observe that time period, then the digestion will not have taken place effectively, and you open the tap to release the waste, then that will mean that that some of the useful organic matter would have that would have been digested by the bacteria has now gone to waste. So it means that you're not going to get sufficient biogas as a result of you not observing the retention time. The retention time is the period between when you are release, when you're opening the tap for the inlet and when you're releasing the outlet. That period is quite crucial. Then the last thing is something that I've mentioned, the methanogens, these bacteria, they do not require outside oxygen. They get their oxygen from the organic matter that you supply, but not from the from the free oxygen. So if there is oxygen in the system that's allowed to get in them, that will lead to the digestive failure. So you need to ensure that the digester is made in such a way that there will not be any cracks in the system, or something that will allow atmospheric oxygen to really come into the system. So I think I'm going to mention a few things from my practical experience in the anaerobic digestion, which you need to take into consideration if you're thinking about trying to come up with your own, probably a small anaerobic digester. If you want to make up a small anaerobic digester before you really go into to making a big digester. So I think I'm just going to give those facts in a short while. Okay, thank you.